think I have mentioned before that I'm very cautious about ranking things taught in the Bible according to their order of importance. We often do that, though. We'll make statements like, this is the most important thing. The most important thing is fill in the blank. Prayer is the most important thing that a Christian does. The Lord's Supper is the most important part of the Sunday morning worship service. Maybe those statements are not meant to be understood as a statement of absolute value. Maybe it's just a way of saying that whatever it is extremely important. But that's not exactly what we say. But unless the Bible actually says that something is the most important or that it is more important than something else, we may be claiming something that the Bible doesn't actually claim. So we need to be careful with that. Take, for example, though, the major events of the Bible. What is the single most important event mentioned in the Bible? Well, someone might say the creation is the most important because without creation, none of the other events could even have occurred. And there's truth to that. The sin of Adam and Eve is certainly important because the history of the world was radically changed from that moment forward. Other important events were important in part because of how they related to the sin of Adam and Eve event. Most of us, though, would probably be most inclined to say that the Christ event is the most important event recorded in Scripture, and especially the death and resurrection of Christ. That provides the remedy for the death. It would be hard, I guess, to argue against the death and resurrection of Christ as being the most important event in history. But we also need to bring into the picture the second coming of Christ. It hasn't happened yet, but it is mentioned, in a sense, recorded in Scripture. It is the event that made the first coming of Christ necessary. If there is no second coming of Christ with final judgment, then there wasn't much need to have the first coming of Christ. Eventually, it's somewhat a futile exercise to spend much time debating which of these events is the most important event, because each of these events derives its importance in conjunction with all of the others. And Scripture seldom comes out and says, this is the most important whatever. That said, Peter's focus in 2 Peter is the second coming of Christ. The things that he writes are saturated with acknowledgement of the first coming of Christ, but the letter was needed and the letter was written because Christ is coming again. Christ is coming again, and some false teachers were teaching that, no, he's not. He is not coming again. Peter's readers knew that Christ is coming again, and Peter writes to reaffirm them in that belief. For Peter, it was imperative that they keep the second coming of Christ in view. Belief in the second coming of Christ determines our worldview. If we believe that Christ is coming again, we want to be prepared and we live in a way that helps us to be prepared. If we believe that Christ is coming again, we have hope for the future, and that hope is a lot more than just believing that we might have a few good years left. Now, this next statement may sound a bit strange to us, or totally strange to us, but it still appears to be true. Most, not all, most non-Christians don't believe that Christ is coming again, and many of them don't care if he is or he isn't. But in the first century, and even in the 21st century, there were and there are Christians, or people calling themselves Christians, who don't believe that Christ is coming again. They believe that Jesus was a great man. He was a great teacher. They liked the ethical values that he presented. But they don't believe the supernatural part, the miracles and heaven or hell. And it seems like some of the false teachers referenced by Peter in 2 Peter were something along that line in their beliefs. They believed that a man named Jesus had lived and died, maybe even that he had died a martyr's death. He had brought a great new philosophy to the world. But it was all about this life and not at all about a supposed life to come. And every day, and every week, every month, every year that went by, and the second coming didn't happen, made their theory sound a bit more plausible. And many Christians apparently were beginning to have doubts. Peter begins chapter 3 of his second letter by stating once again that he wasn't teaching them anything that they didn't already know. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 1, "But beloved, I now write to you this second epistle, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of reminder." What he was about to write and what he had been writing for two chapters was by way of reminder. And this gives us a little hint, looking backwards, of what the apostles taught the church in early days. They either taught about the second coming and final judgment in their gospel presentations, or they taught it in their new converts class. But Peter knew that his readers knew the things that he was about to write, and he was simply writing to remind them, to reinforce their faith. And the things that they already knew and believed. Four times in this little letter, he reminds them that all he was doing was reminding them. There was nothing new, no new revelation, so to speak, in this letter. In chapter 1, in verses 12 and 15, he says that this is only a reminder of factual information that they had already received. And now here in verse 1 and again in verse 17 of chapter 3 of the second letter, he says the same thing. Verse 17, he says, "You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked." Not only did Peter teach about second coming of Christ and final judgment, but so did, he says, the apostle Paul, down in verse 15. "And consider that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you." It may be that Peter was writing to Christians who had had a lot of contact with the apostle Paul. He actually says here that they had also received something written to them by the apostle Paul. So that would explain why Peter mentions Paul here specifically. But Peter knew that not only he and Paul taught this doctrine, but so did all of the authentic apostles and prophets of Christ, as well as prophets from the Old Testament. That's verse 2. "That you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior." Peter highlights two things that Jesus taught, that the prophets taught, that the apostles taught. One of those things was that Jesus would come back and that there would be a final judgment. But they also taught that others would teach against that doctrine. Peter calls them scoffers, verse 3. "Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last day, walking according to their own lust." Scoffers would scoff at the idea that Christ was coming back for final judgment. And the reason that they would deny this idea was that they were motivated by their own lust or by their own evil desires. And we should probably understand a fairly broad meaning for this expression, evil desires. We read that and we tend to think, or tend to limit the meaning to a desire to live a horribly reprobate lifestyle. The New King James Version says lust, and We associate lust with improper sexual desires. And it would certainly include sexual lust, but it would also include any desire that would lead a person to disregard the idea of final judgment. Some very decent people don't live totally degenerate lives, but they want to live their lives on their own terms, not on God's terms. They want to please their own desires, which may in some cases be relatively noble desires, but not as an expression of faith in God or of dependence on God. They live according to their own desires, be they good or bad. This presents a basic idea that a person's level of interest in the gospel is predetermined by the importance they give to their own desires. The evidence that supports any biblical teaching is the same for every person who looks at that evidence or who has the opportunity to look at that evidence. And even with the many different translations that we have, anyone who has a Bible has basically the same Bible. But some pay close attention to it, some pay less attention to it, and some don't pay any attention to it. One reason for that is the strength and the nature of their own desires. So in short, some people, and all of us to some extent, some people want to live life their way. Think of the famous Frank Sinatra song, "I did it my way." And they prefer, therefore, because of that, they prefer to deny the possibility of an eternal day of accountability. The argument they were using was a form of uniformitarianism. Now, technically, uniformitarianism is a geological term. It means this. It means that existing processes acting in the same manner as at present are sufficient to account for all geological changes. Give an example of that. If we see that it takes, and this is just, I don't know if these numbers are right, but they're just for illustration. If we see that it takes, let's say, 10 years for a stream to cause enough erosion to deepen the stream bed by 3 inches, then you simply divide those 3 inches into the depth of the Grand Canyon, and you know how old the Grand Canyon is. The rate of erosion today is assumed to be the same rate that it has always been. Everything is uniform, therefore uniformitarianism. But that geological theory, flawed as it is, bleeds over into a general outlook on life. The idea being, well, just look at history. People have always been pretty much the way they are today, and the human race seems to have survived nonetheless. God hasn't judged, condemned, or punished yet. Therefore, we believe that He never will. Peter's description of the scoffers is that they say, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. That is a general worldview of uniformitarianism. The fallacy of their argument, Peter says, is that they willfully forget a lot of things. And one of the big things that they forget is God's worldwide act of punishment in the days of Noah. Now, once again, Peter is referencing the great flood in the days of Noah to support what he is saying. He referred to the flood in 1 Peter chapter 3, referred to the flood in 2 Peter chapter 2, and now again in 2 Peter chapter 3. History may be somewhat repetitive and monotonous. Things may stay pretty much the same much of the time. But there have been times when God interrupted history with catastrophes of various sizes. God may have built some of those catastrophes into nature, into creation. When the Mississippi River or the Missouri River floods, that may be the result of forces that God has built into His creation. And He may let those so-called natural forces dominate most of the time. But we should note that even those built-in catastrophes would be enough to throw off uniformitarian timetables. But that does not mean that God has never and will never interrupt history with exceptional acts of God. By the word of God, the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water, Peter says. Genesis 1 said that the creation was by the word of God, and God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. By the word of God, the flood of Noah's day changed the course of history. And by a word of God yet to be pronounced, the world will again be destroyed, this time by fire. That event will be, Peter says, for the judgment and perdition of ungodly men. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7. The simple truth is that God's timetable and God's reasons are beyond man's understanding. God is not bound by time like we are. Time is an amazing thing. Philosophers have a lot of fun working with the concept of time. I recently read a biography of Albert Einstein. His life was interesting, but his theory of relativity was totally baffling to a non-scientific mind like my own. But we can still understand that our perception of time is variable. Basically, we look at a clock, analog, not digital, and when the skinny hand has made a whole circuit, we know that that is 1 minute. But when you have a lot to do and not much time to get it done, a minute seems oh so terribly short. Even an hour seems to fly by. If I were to stand here, not say a word, without explaining to you why I was doing it for a minute, a whole minute would seem like a long time. When a baby cries in the middle of the sermon, for a whole minute seems like an eternity for the parents. Peter used that argument to explain that God's perception of time was not the same as our own perception. When Peter wrote this letter, Christ had left the earth some 35 to 40 years earlier. Scoffers were saying that 40 years is a long time, and if Christ was going to come back, surely He would have done it by now. Peter responded that what may seem like a day for us was long enough for God to accomplish 1,000 years of work. And what seemed like 1,000 years to us, that was like a single day for God. Verse 8. But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. People who like to interpret prophecy sometimes want to use this verse as a conversion table for converting prophecy time into earth time. This approach says that if a prophecy says one day, well, that means 1,000 years in real time. And of course, they use this rate of conversion only when it fits a conclusion they have already determined, because sometimes one day means only 1 year and it varies, but in some cases they'll lock onto this. Peter is not giving a prophetic conversion table like you might have a conversion table to convert metric measurement into inches and feet. All he is saying is that what might seem like a long time to us doesn't seem like a long time to God. So the argument of God taking what seems like a long time before judging the earth is no indication of whether it will actually happen or not. There's a much more comforting reason for what seems to be this long delay, which is now up to about 2,000 years. Verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. When we are feeling righteous, and we see people whom we consider to be sinners, we are ready for judgment anytime, sooner the better. Deal with all that evil. Fortunately, for everyone, God's slowness is really God's patience. God is not slack concerning His promises to send Christ back, but He is patient. God was giving even the leading scoffers time to reconsider. Peter is affirming a truth that can be traced from the sin of Adam to the end of the book of Revelation. And that truth is, God will punish. Being a God of righteousness and justice requires that He punish sin. But He doesn't find any pleasure in doing it. He much prefers that all sinners come to repentance. He doesn't want anyone to perish. And if waiting a bit longer helps, He waits. Sometimes we read the Old Testament and we are tempted to see a mean, harsh God. But at the same time, in that same Old Testament, we see a God who more often than not was very patient, waiting even centuries longer than any of us would have been willing to wait. But even with His patience, and this is very important, this is what Peter's driving at, even His patience has limits. And judgment eventually came in those Old Testament stories. The Old Testament, like the New Testament, shows the reality of God's patience and His love, but it also shows the certainty of punishment. Not only is the ultimate day of punishment certain, but the timing of it is unannounced and will be unannounced. Verse 10, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise. The elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up." When people try to use that 1,000 years equals a day conversion table, it's often to predict when Christ will come. And that's exactly what Peter, all the apostles, and Jesus taught that we should not try to do. From the beginning, Jesus taught the importance of constant readiness. He didn't want people to be cramming for finals because they thought they had figured out just how long they could wait and then still have time to repent and get in under the wire. Final judgment will be like an unannounced pop quiz. You know it's coming, but you don't know when. Now, this is an idea that we often connect with the idea of final judgment, but it applies not only to final judgment. The first recorded use of the thief in the night analogy that we have was by Jesus Himself in Matthew chapter 24. In Matthew 24, verses 43 and 44, Jesus says, "But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Now, there is debate over whether this verse is about final judgment or about the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Certain details in various verses of Matthew 24 seem to support one or the other of those. But the unexpected thief in the night idea can go either way, and it really doesn't change much. Many times God has, through Scripture and through history, many times God has executed judgment, and it was sudden and it was without warning. And each of those judgments set a precedent for final judgment. But the message has always been the same. The message being, quit trying to figure out the timing and be ready all the time. But some were even asking, why should we get ready at all? He's not even coming back. And Peter answered, because we know for sure that sooner or later it will happen. It might happen when Christ comes again, or it might happen when some drunk runs a red light and T-bones your car. But it will happen, and you need to be ready whenever that is. The warnings of Matthew 24 are followed by three parables in Matthew 25. All of those three parables are judgment parables. We have the wise and foolish virgins, we have the 5, 2, and 1 talent men, and we have the separation of the sheep from the goats. In each parable, you end up with two groups. When the time of reckoning came, one group was ready and received their reward. The other group was not ready and received decisive punishment. In that split second, when we realize that the time has come, and the trumpet sounds and the clouds roll back and Christ appears, either our worst fears or our greatest dreams will be realized. For those who are not ready, it will be a horrible moment. It will be horrible because they will see that instead of scoffing, they should have been taking advantage of God's patience to get ready. For the others, it will be as the song says, "And Lord, haste the day when the faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back to the scroll, the trump shall resound, the Lord shall descend. Even so, it's well with my soul." Let's make sure that we are among those who are looking forward to these things. "Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by Him in peace, without spot and blameless." And in the last two verses of Peter's letter, "You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory both now and forever. Amen." What a horrible tragedy to have wasted opportunities like today to get ready. Believe that through faith in the death and resurrection of Christ, you can be ready to greet Him without fear of punishment. Use this moment of God's patience to turn away from sin. Don't just say, "I'm going to do better someday," but determine to resist temptation by doing things that will really help you to avoid and resist temptation. Then be baptized in that symbolic fellowship with the death of Christ. Come out of the water dedicated to living a holy, godly life so that you can look forward in hope to that day when Christ returns. If we can help you do that, let us know while we stand and sing.